Da det på tide med utdeling av mannsprisen og kvinneprisen. Det da en pris som Mannsforum gir ut en gang I året til en mann og en kvinne som da har, som vi mener, har gjort en ekstra innsats I året som har, har vært. Relatert da til, til likestilling, jeg skal ikke si et mannsperspektiv, men I hvert fall som har med, med menns likestilling å gjøre. Og da tenker jeg at jeg skal starte med å si litt om kvinnen som, som har vunnet I år. Hun får prisen for hennes positive holdning og politiske arbeid for full kjønnslikestilling mellom mødre og fedre og kvinner og menn. Kvinnen vi snakker om heter Guri Melby. Ja. Guri Melby, hun var en pådriver for at Venstre I sitt partiprogram gikk inn for delt bosted og sanksjoner mot samværssabotasje. Hun har også vært positiv til å gjøre likestillings- og diskrimineringsloven kjønnsnøytral. Guri Melby, hun utdannet lektor og har vært aktiv politiker fra 1999. Og hun var byråd for miljø og samferdsel I Oslo 2013 til 2015. Og hun har vært sentralstyremedlem fra 2010 og stortingsrepresentant fra 2017 og leder Venstres programarbeid. Og vi, vi mener at Guri hun har utmerket seg med god kunnskap om forskningen på delt bosted, og hun har jobbet hardt for selvstendig opptjeningsrett og tredelt foreldrepermisjon gjennom flere kronikker og medieutspill, på tross av kritikk fra rasende kvinner og mødre I kommentarfeltene. Jeg har selv vært med å forsvare Guri noen ganger I disse kommentarfeltene, og det, ja, det ikke bare menn som kan bli sinnet, for å si det sånn. Så Guri Melba, hun fremstår, Melby fremstår med sitt aktive politiske engasjement for likestilling og likestilt foreldreskap som et godt eksempel for andre politikere og en verdig vinner av Mannsforums kvinnepris 2019. Dette da, vi prøver jo alltid å benytte enhver anledning til å gi litt bøker som kan øke kunnskapen om våre temaer. Ja, vil du se, si noen ord selv?
Tusen takk. Det her en pris som det en stor ære for meg å motta. Den henger veldig høyt. Jeg synes jo at noe av det aller beste som har skjedd I Norge de siste 15-20 årene, måten pappaen har kommet på banen. Hvis du sammenligner den tilstedeværelsen som fedre har I dag I sine barns liv, med bare for en generasjon eller to siden, så det helt annerledes. Og den som har aller mest å tjene på det, bortsett fra mannen selv, altså klart, selvsagt ungene. Det betyr at det veldig mange flere barn I dag som har to nære omsorgspersoner, som de akkurat like trygge på. Det betyr at de får veldig mange flere muligheter til å utvikle seg som mennesker. Men så mener jeg også at det veldig positivt for kvinnen, at menn har tatt stadig mer ansvar I heimen og for barna, Det gir også kvinnen flere muligheter. Så det som menn har gjort bidrar til mer likestilling. Det bidrar til bedre liv, både for menn, kvinner og ikke minst barna. Og det her synes jeg så bra at det veldig viktig at vi som politikere støtter opp under den utviklingen. Jeg tror ikke at det vi politikere som har skapt den utviklingen. Det har vært mange tiltak, sånn som fedrekvote og sånn. Jeg tror faktisk det I stor grad menn som har skapt det selv, men vi har vært med og lagt til rette og stimulert at det har blitt forsterket. Derfor så har jeg også da kjempet for blant annet tredeling av foreldrepermisjon. Den kampen har vi jo da foreløpig vunnet, selv om jeg ikke tar det for gitt at det kommer til å bli sånn. Jeg tror den kampen står fortsatt. Men det er selvsagt flere ting vi er nødt til å vinne gjennom med. Vi er nødt til å sørge for selvstendig opptjeningsrett. Det har både en veldig stor praktisk betydning, men også en sånn symbolbetydning, for det sier noe om hva slags rolle mor og far fortsatt har. Og så er det selvsagt veldig mye som må gjøres når det handler om omsorgsfordeling og alt det her, som er kjempekomplisert, og sørge for at det ikke skal være kjønn som avgjør hvem det er som får lov til å være sammen med ungene. Så jeg vil bare si tusen takk til den jobben som dere gjør, dere som her i dag. Dere gjør et kjempeviktig arbeid. Jeg har dessverre ikke kunnet vært der tidligere i dag, men det virker som en veldig bra konferanse, så jeg håper at dere legger ut alt på nett etterpå, så jeg får oppdatert meg også. For her må vi faktisk alle stadig oppdatere oss på ny kunnskap. Så det er veldig bra at dere bidrar å spre det. Så lover jeg at jeg fortsatt skal kjempe for likestilling, sånn at vi alle sammen får det bedre. Takk.
Ja, Guri... nevnte det med fedre og fedres rolle i dag, hvordan den har endret seg de siste par generasjonene, og at det gagner begge. Det kan jeg bare fullt ut støtte. Jeg har selv tilbrakt et halvt år hjemme med datteren min, fra hun var et halvt til et år. Og har hatt veldig mye av ansvaret frem til vi ikke bodde sammen lenger. Og jeg har sagt det flere ganger, det var veldig slitsomt, men jeg har sagt det at til alle disse fedrene som tilbringer lange dager på jobb og overlater hovedansvaret til mor, dere aner ikke hva dere går glipp av. Det er verdt all innsats. Da er vi over på Mannsforums mannspris. Og han som får den, han får den for hans modige forfatterskap, hvor han med utgangspunkt i personlige erfaringer skriver åpent om menns særlige likestillingsutfordringer i Norge. Likestillingens hjemland, som det kalles. Hans bok, som vi har nevnt et par ganger allerede i dag, «Mitt liv som mann», innvarsler et paradigmeskifte i norsk kjønns- og likestillingsdebatt, der menn omsider kom på banen og deltar aktivt i debatten på egne premisser. Og han er forfatter, filmregissør og dosent ved Teaterhøgskolen, og heter Øystein Stene, og han har gjennom en ensom barndom, utfordrende ungdomsår, kreativ utdanning og variert yrkesliv, gjort seg erfaringer som mann i feministisk preget tid og miljø. Fra politisk ståsted så er han på venstresiden og tidlig feminist. Har han med stigende undring følt seg fremmedgjort som mann i venstresidens ensidig kjønnsperspektiv, kvinnefokus og mannslede. Det var et nytt ord for meg. Ja, ja. Etter å ha skrevet et kritisk essay om MeToo i 2018, ble Stene utskjelt på sosiale medier og mottok etter hvert anonyme dødstrusler i posten signert «Alle kvinner». Som den modige mann han er, lot han seg ikke skremme til taushet, men ble heller inspirert til å fortelle historien om sine møter med feminisme, slik han har opplevd det i praksis på sin vei gjennom livet. «Mitt liv som mann» er en bok om å være mann i et skandinavisk sosialdemokrati der likestilling og kvinnekamp for lengst har endret samfunnet. Boka beskriver hvor mannen står i møte med disse fortellingene, hvilket lys de kaster på han, og hva de mørkelegger. Øystein Stene, han fremstår med sin viktige bok som et godt eksempel for andre menn, og er en verdig vinner av Mannsforums mannspris 2019. Ordet er ditt.
Takk. Tusen takk. Jeg måtte forberede meg litt her. Altså. Takk til juryen, som jeg forstår også er Mannsforums styre. Ja. Altså, før altså i går så var jeg på forlaget og snakket med forleggerne mine, som er altså Gloria forlag, som består av en gjeng kvinner. To av dem sitter bakerst der. Og det takket være de at denne boka ble skrevet i utgangspunktet, var de som oppfordret meg til å skrive den etter den MeToo-debatten. Og vi satt og snakket om liksom denne mannsprisen, så sa jeg at det er liksom pussy da, at en mann som kommer liksom fra feminismen, og som ikke liker fotball, og som aldri har vært på skotske barer, får mannspris. Og så sier da forlagssjefen, ser strengt på meg, så sier det at det ikke er skotske barer, just den dette irske pubba. Og for meg så illustrerer det kanskje et av hovedpoengene i boka mi, nemlig at det er ekstremt stor diversitet blant menn. Og vi vet av all forskning tilsier at det er større diversitet blant menn enn kvinner. Vi finner flere på toppen, men vi finner også flere på bunnen. Og det som er det som på en måte er en av de tingene som har slått meg veldig når jeg har jobbet med denne boka, er hvordan vi spesielt de siste 20 årene har fått en likestillingskamp eller en likestillingsarbeid som handler om topposisjoner, kamp om topposisjoner, heller enn solidaritet med de som befinner seg på bunnen. Og den forskyvning, liksom hele kjønnssamtalen, som uroer oss mange, uansett hvor vi befinner oss politisk, eller hvordan vi tenker om kjønn, tenker jeg. Så det har på en måte vært liksom noe av utgangspunktet mitt. Det er nå en uke siden jeg ble oppringt av Mannsforum, og fikk denne jeg ble spurt da, kunne du tenke deg å motta mannsprisen? Og det var supergøy spørsmål, men jeg stusset litt på problemstillingen, så jeg liksom gravde og spurte litt, hvorfor spør du på den måten, hvorfor sier du gratulerer med prisen? Liksom. Og da ble det jo ganske sånn klart for meg at liksom, ok, de tenker at jeg som mottaker tenker at det er kontroversielt å motta prisen. Og det gjør at jeg i meg selv stusset, at bare det stusset over liksom. Selv etter å skrive denne boka, så er det liksom sånn, oi, vi er der fremdeles liksom. At etter 150-200 års samtale om kvinners posisjon og rolle i samfunnet, det er fremdeles kontroversielt å snakke om mannens rolle og posisjon. Det tenker jeg at liksom er noe vi må gjøre noe med. Det finnes altså noen fortellinger om kjønn som er så ekstremt sementerte at det ser ut til å være nesten klin umulig å rikke på. Og det eneste jeg ønsker å bidra med denne boka er å liksom å være med og se om det går an å åpne det landskapet til å snakke om menn og mannsrollen på mange forskjellige måter. Dessverre så leser jo menn mindre enn kvinner. Altså, fjorårets undersøkelse viser at menn leser halvparten så mange bøker som kvinner. Jeg tenker at menn må være med på dette selv. Som Warren Farrell sier, women can't hear what men don't say. Og det at vi må bidra til å skrive, lese, tenke, snakke, debattere om disse temaene, er utrolig viktig. Og da kan vi ikke bli skremt av at dette oppfattes som kontroversielt. Jeg tror ikke at denne skuta lar seg snu umiddelbart, men den lar seg snu, og den må la seg snu. Det er jeg helt overbevist om. Og da tenker jeg at nettopp de aktivitetene som Mannsforum har, dette seminaret, det at vi snakker sammen og blir bevisst disse spørsmålene, er helt fundamentale. Derfor har jeg lyst til å rette en stor takk til Mannsforum for dette seminaret. Tusen takk. Det gir håp om at en ny generasjon gutter kan få være med å definere kjønnssamtalen og likestillingsspørsmål på lik linje med jenter, og at solidaritet med menn blir like selvfølgelig for oss som solidaritet med kvinner. Tusen takk.
Da overlater vi ordet til Guttorm igjen, som introduserer neste speaker. Over to English.
Yeah, the next speaker and the last speaker is Asle Toye, who is a political scientist, and he also is allowed to say that you're in the Nobel Peace Prize Committee. But that's no secret, but that's not the main thing. The main thing is that he's a free-speaking soul. He looks from quite a lot of interesting angles at what happens in our society, and so also on the gender side. So, Asle, we're looking forward to hear you.
Thank you.
Så, kjære venner. Jeg får ta så anlegge ansiktet I den litt sånn selvhøytidlig minen som nordmenn anlegger når vi skal snakke til på utenlandsk til et overveiende norsk publikum. Dear friends and others, I'm here to talk to you about the lost boys and the legacy of state feminism. And I would like to start with an anecdote. I recently visited one of the leading colleges in the United States, where there amongst the faculty had been a concern that the student mass wasn't reflecting the population, that there was a need for quotas. And so they started a big survey to find out what quota, what people are not represented. And what they found out was that the group missing most at this college were white boys from the working class. And as soon as they established this, they decided that there was no more need for equality. And they just shelved the whole thing. The point I'm trying to get across here is that the underlying current behind the discussion that we're having today here about boys' rights is an adverse structure, a hierarchy of victimhood, if you'd like, where boys find themselves as the least worthy of victims. And when they are discriminated against, it is often taken to be their own fault or a sign that society is progressing. I believe that is intensely harmful. In the discussions here today, we have talked about how school is a core arena where boys increasingly, at least over the past two decades or so, have been losing out. I would like to direct your attentions besides, I think the point that was made about Norway about starting schools at 5.5 is a very bad idea for boys. And it was never discussed when we made the decision. And now that the data are in, there seems to be a great eagerness to bury our collective heads in the sand and just ignore the fact that starting that early in school disadvantages boys. Another issue that I would like to highlight is one that I think that very many parents, men and women, see equally, and that is screen time, boys and gaming. The American Association of Pediatricians have recommended that children should not spend more than 2 hours a day in front of a screen. And all I can say to that is good luck with that. I think that all parents find this to be a great challenge. And there can be no question that when it comes to gaming and social media, etc., the boys are the hardest hit. Sean Parker, who was one of the people who started Facebook, put out a statement that that was a bit disturbing, I would say. He says, "God knows what this does to the brains of our children." And what we have found in recent scholarship is that the brain is a much more malleable organ than we first thought. We thought that you know, we were born with the capacities, largely inherited, and things would progress from there. It seems that online activities such as gaming and pornography, and I would like to just underline like one interesting finding from Edward Snowden's great expose about his time of exposing the secrets of America, and the journalist asked him, what is the one thing that would surprise people? And he says, the big surprise is that everyone watches porn. Absolutely everybody, says the CIA. And we can make light of this. But what we find is that the brain is more malleable than we first have thought. And the way that gaming, pornography, etc., redirects the neural pathways in the brain is worrisome. And this is very closely tied to how much time you spend on these activities. And since these activities trigger dopamine, the online presence and the enjoyment in the brain seems to increase and to be, you get a causal pathway that is, when it comes to gaming, social media, YouTube, etc., is intensely debilitating, especially for boys, since boys spend more time on social media than others. Of course, both Facebook and Google, etc., have done much the same as the tobacco lobby did when they were confronted with these disturbing findings. They have invested in their own scientists who will have gone on to prove that their product is indeed completely safe and that everybody's crying wolf. But what we see is that amongst boys in this country, more than 50% of boys spend more than 3 hours every day in front of a screen. And especially when it comes to gaming, one might say that the people who develop games, and this is no small industry, it's a $137 billion industry. They make that much money each year. It's a bigger industry than sports. All sports is gaming. And they have in some ways hacked the brains of humans. We're not very complex creatures. What we want, you can count more or less on five fingers. You know, I think Jordan Peterson has laid this out quite well. The question is, what happens when we are confronted with science in our society that a large group of boys are falling behind, and they're falling behind rapidly? In Sweden, they had a national white paper, Pojkutvalget. Pojkkrisen, that was supposed to analyze the boys' crisis. And what they found was that, and they concluded, and I love this, they talk about a masculine culture that undervalues academic success. So it's the boys' own fault. They have a cultural problem, and they will need to be reprogrammed. Be that as it may, what we see is that, according to the OECD, at the time of ending school, girls are a full year ahead of the boys. And they spend 1 hour more a week doing their homework. And I'm sure that we've already been through some of the statistics from Norway, from the Stoltenberg survey, where we find that boys get poorer grades than girls in 90% of topics taught in school, with the notable exception of gym, which is, I think we can all agree, not the most important topic academically in school. Boys are also much more likely to receive a diagnosis during their time in school. And I think that this all funnels into to my concern. And that is, to give you another anecdote, I was down in Arendal, for the week of politics in August, and I was drafted into a panel where the main claim was that we need to teach emotional intelligence in school. It was quite interesting. If you put a title like that, there will be no men in the audience. There was absolutely no men who wanted to hear about the need to teach emotional intelligence in school. I was the lone dissenting voice saying that boys are losing more than enough in school. Why on earth would we want to introduce another topic where they will also lose out? Because it seems that the reason, according to the Stoltenberg survey, the reason why, or part of it at least, why girls get better grades is because teachers like them more. Teachers is an intensely women-dominated topic or walk of life in Norway, and the boys are doing as well as the girls when it comes to the national exams. They just get worse grades from their teachers. The scholar Thomas G. Mortensen, an American scholar, has argued that in many ways, the problem boils down to boys lacking good role models. And and I'm sure we can all agree, the statistics are very, very clear on this. The best thing you can do for your children is to remain married. That goes for boys and girls. That increases their success statistically in the future of their lives more than pretty much any other variable. If you cannot remain married, and some of us can't, I think the big lesson is that you have to remain involved, especially in your boys' lives. Boys need masculine role models, and this is also what the scholarship of Professor Mortensen points to. But he also points to what he calls feminist dogma in education that prizes values associated with girls. And amongst these qualities is that education has become increasingly centered on feelings, increasingly risk averse, increasingly opposed to competition, and sedentary, i.e. sitting on your ass for more of the time. And it seems that this is not really working out all that well for boys, and it's part of the reason, part and parcel, some would say, why boys are falling behind. We had a documentary on Norwegian television called The Sex War, Kjønnskrigen, where some of these findings were highlighted. And I think it's important to step away from this war rhetoric. In my experience, there is no sex war. There is a cadre of highly motivated, very chauvinistic feminists who do not represent all women, and a much broader population of men and women who just want to make this work. And this is where I find myself squarely. I also found that you would think that this soiree down in Arendal would turn out very, very bitterly for me, since I was the lone dissenting voice. But I made an appeal to the audience and said, in the audience, there are only women. Some of you, I think, have fathers. Some of you have brothers. Some of you have sons. So you know men. Have you tried talking about feelings with your husband or with your son? Personally, I would rather be waterboarded. And many men are like me. And so this idea to introduce sort of another topic in school that is focused on touchy-feely feeling stuff is something that many boys will abhor and receive more bad grades, and which is, of course, the opposite. So I'm not sure if we should look for solutions from the feminist side, i.e., you know, the reprogramming route. Make the boys more like girls, and they're going to work out fine. I don't think that is a viable path. I think we are finding ourselves in a situation where, as a society, we have gone wrong. When you look out at the dropout figures for Norwegian high schools, roughly speaking, 27%, roughly speaking, a quarter of boys do not finish high school. This is not just a gender issue, this is also a class issue. It's usually boys from low-skilled, low-educated households who fall into this situation. And this is extremely expensive for society. And one might ask oneself, if any other group had fallen out at the same rate and at the same cost, wouldn't society have done something? And they haven't. And I think this, dear friends, is the legacy of state feminism. I think that we have created a movement that is that keeps on focusing on women's rights. Now, as one speaker pointed out, it's much about fighting for ever more high positions for women. It's not enough that pretty much every leadership position in Norway is filled by women already today. As long as there are any positions that are filled by men, feminism haven't had enough success. I think that we need to counter this discussion with an actual problem, because for me, highly educated, extremely successful women not being prime minister is not a very big problem. They're doing fine. They're gonna be fine, even if they're not prime minister. I think that we need to focus much more about the boys that keep falling out of school. And I think that it's been profoundly unhelpful that we've had a discourse that has, with very few naysayers, taken it upon itself to define masculinity as something inherently toxic, which, well, I'm a man, so I can say that's bullshit. It's bullshit. And regardless of that, it has entered into the discourse, and I think that in some ways, when Claire Berlinski in The American Interest points out over Me Too, that we have a crime that is festooned with a swift and draconian punishment, but no definition of the crime, then we have a problem. She was forced to recount that, even if it is the most obvious statement one could say. She was forced to recount. And I think that this tendency to define masculinity as something inherently negative is a great problem. But friends, I think the solution is right here. I do believe in recent discourse. I do believe that in a democracy, making your argument in a reasonable manner actually works. I experienced that myself in Arendal, that after the discussion, I got more applause than everybody else because a lot of women see the same issues. And therefore, I think that we should step away from this war analogy. I don't think there is a war out there. I think that the mechanisms of social democracy, which I believe to have been one of inclusion, to bring in ever more groups, the groups that have fallen behind, are compensated and brought in. It's good for society, it's good for the individual, it's good for the economy, it's good for marriage, it's good for all of it. I think this is the path forth also for men. But for that to happen, I think that we need to couch the debate in the terminology that you've heard here today, that there is a boys' problem. It's not necessarily an immigrant problem or a social economic problem. It's a boys' problem. And these boys are a resource to our society that this society currently is denying itself. It's stupid and it needs to stop. And one of the things that I would recommend, I think, is we need to look at prejudice in school against boys. And we really, really need to stop this IT-ification of education, where children and the boys spend ever more time on iPads, etc., with the assumption that they should have enough self-discipline to do their maths instead of playing their latest video game. Because let's face it, that's not going to work. And how can we as parents tell our kids not to spend so much time on the screen when we ourselves are so very manifestly addicted to the same? Dear friends, these were my initial remarks. I was hoping that perhaps we could have a couple of minutes for some questions from the audience, if there are any, that is. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And we do have 5 minutes for questions.
Wonderful.
So, first one out is... again, from this side. Yeah, this is the intellectual side. Russia.
This is a bit complicated, but I'll try to be brief. You mentioned this about screen addiction. It might the question also might go slightly outside our themes. Mentioned this about screen addiction, but at least according to what I read about research that, among others, Jonathan Haidt has been involved in, who you obviously know who is, screen addiction, when it comes to boys, seem to be more the opposite. The causality runs the other way, that boys that have problems other areas seems to use screens more, while it's kind of opposite with girls, where there is seen to be more likely that their actual use of screens, although it's kind of somewhat less than boys, have larger detrimental, at least mental health effects than on boys. But that boys' problems come from other sources, basically.
Yes, I think that's a plausible question.
No, so it's a very good question, and I'm familiar with Professor Haidt's research. What he points out is that parenting is an important aspect of this, because boys from families without much, let's call it, cultural capital don't have parents who put curbs on how much screen time they have. Of course, boys and girls distinguish themselves, with girls devoting more time to social media and boys more to gaming, where, let's face it, killing is an outlet for aggressive feelings, I think, to some extent, for the boys. I'm not against gaming, and I don't think that gaming in itself is a huge problem. The problem is that for many boys, this is their substitute for a social life. This is their substitute for playing football or ice hockey or roaming the forest with their friends. And I think that the problem is, if boys are not taught what it means to be a man, and we do learn that largely from other men in groups, that's how we are socialized. If we are not taken through these experiences, I think that many men will struggle to find a viable role in their life later. This is bad for women. It's bad for I think that the problem with if a quarter of boys fall out of high school and will end up in this substrata, women over time will find difficulties in finding enough men to marry, and that is what we've seen amongst certain groups, not least in the United States, where women are very hesitant to marry men who are much lower educated than themselves. And so it's also an investment for the future prospects of women, those who want to be married, to invest in the boys.
Hello. Oh, I'm not used to mics, but wonderful speech, gentlemen. I believe man and woman is a bit like yin and yang. It is the sammanlignet med old cultures. It goes several thousand years back. But women is night, man is day, and you can go on like that. But where are we going to start with this? How do we start? How do we get one inch up in this?
You mean...
You only have 2 minutes to answer.
That is a big question, where to start. As I said, I think that we need to tone down the war rhetoric. I think that is polarizing, and I think it's profoundly unhelpful. I think that it overshadows the fact that there is a reasonable middle ground where the vast majority of us, men and women, feel very comfortable in. And I think that those forces who are trying to, be it the cyst movement or hardcore feminists, who are trying to create much harder fronts than is necessary. But I think also my experience, and that is, you know, like, I might be wrong about that, but there's someone there for everybody. I think that for every woman, there is a man just the way like she would like her man. And there is, for every man, there is a woman that suits his needs, and it's a wonderful thing. We call it love. And I do think that we need to try and hold on to that, because, and this is of course intensely unscientific, I myself am married, and I must say that my wife has helped make me a better person without there being sort of without sending me to a reschooling camp. And I do think that I have also made her a better woman in many ways, and that's you know, how a well-functioning marriage works. I know sometimes it's hard, and I think it's very, very easy to go to a dark place, especially those who have experienced divorces and those who experience finding it difficult to have contact with their children, finding themselves blocked. I think it's very easy to get into a sort of a bunker mentality. And I put it to you that the bunker mentality is the problem. And I think that as long as make your voice heard in a reasonable manner and try to think of how to persuade people, and the best way to persuade people is actually to talk to them. You will find that most women are very reasonable. And as long as we stay away from the most emotive and hardcore sloganisms, I think that we will find that good solutions can be found. We have overcome more difficult problems in our society in the past, and I think we will overcome this as well, provided that men don't hide from this debate. And I think it's an uncomfortable debate for many men to have. I think many men feel uncomfortable standing up for their gender and defining themselves. Here I am a man, is something that many men feel uncomfortable with. But I think for the sake of the boys, it's absolutely necessary. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you very much. This was a punchline we wanted, you know, and you gave it to us. That's fantastic. Now the chairman has a gift for you. There's more things to read.
Talk to me.
Thank you very much.